Welcome, Brian McFadden. Thanks for joining us. Now, you said when you were a kid, you had a bit of trouble with the ladies, and now obviously there's no problem, and you're actually courting one of our very famous ladies, Delta. Now, the way you actually discovered Delta was you heard her on the radio, is that correct?
Yeah, because I couldn't believe, like, Delta sold a million albums in the UK in her first album, and yeah. I swear to God, I'd never heard of that movie. I was like, she sold a million, like, there's nobody sells a million albums. It's like maybe three artists a year would sell a million albums, yeah, and right. She was one of them.
Totally.
And then someone told me after I found out about her. So I'd written this song, and I needed someone to sing the girl part.
Oh, when I need you, you're almost here.
And all these different people's names were getting thrown around, and I was just like, no, I could hear the voice, and I was trying to think of a singer I could do it. And then I literally listened to the radio, and Lost Without You came on, and I was like, who the hell is that? And my driver was a big fan of Delta, and he goes, that's Delta Goodrum from Australia. So I made a really rough demo of the song, and yeah. I sent it straight to her. Mm-hmm. And again, she looked at it and goes, who the hell is Brian McFadden? She just said, right, listen, that day she got 10 other songs for people wanting to do a duet with her.
No way.
And she's just like, yeah, whatever. And she got this song last, she's like, oh, not another one. Yeah. And she put it in, listened to it, and I went, wow.
What was it about her voice that you went, that is the voice I'm looking forward to?
When I wrote Almost Here, I wanted the voice to sing it to be really intimate, really angelic, but somebody that could sing with passion without over-singing. And Delta just has this voice where, you know, she can sing any song in the world and make it sound angelic. She can sing a rock song and still make it sound beautiful. And I don't know what it was, it's just she's just got one of them voices that you go, you know, nobody in the world sings like that.
Well, guys, stick around, you're going to see more of this man later on the show. And at a young age, when you're just so incredibly famous, is it hard to keep a level head and you've got sort of so much money and fame? Like, it's a lot of responsibility at such a young age.
I think it'll start to. When it happened initially, it was really wild because I'd just come from school, and a year later, I'm, you know, in Westlife and everyone knows who you are. And it does, like, it goes to your head very instantly. And I have to say, the first year and a half in Westlife, I was like, how brilliant am I?
Yeah, totally.
And then you get used to it and it becomes your job. And then you realise, actually, you're still the same idiot you were before you started.
Totally. And you used to work at McDonald's, man, being a security guard. And
I actually worked at McDonald's right up to the night before I got Westlife. I quit McDonald's on the Friday night and I got into Westlife on the Saturday. I got a glass bottle in the head because literally I was manning the door on my own on a Saturday night in the main street in Dublin, and you got like thousands of people on the street, and I had one man on the door, and I wasn't even a man, I was a boy, I was 16 or 17, and standing there with my long blonde hair like a little queen, and all these drunks, and I'm not letting anyone drunk in, so I had to stop like 15 guys from the door, and I was like, what am I going to do, 15 guys, and you're not coming in, and it was like, whoosh, Budweiser bottle in the head. I was like, okay, I guess you are coming in.
Oh, for real?
And I quit that night and I said, right, what am I going to do now? I just lost my career in McDonald's. And the next day I went for an audition and got into Westlife.
What was the whole audition process like?
Literally, I turned up and there was like hundreds and hundreds of people all queuing. And I didn't want to queue, so one of my friends was working in the club that the audition was on, so he got me in the back, and I just went up and sang, and after I sang, Louis Walsh, who was Boys on the manager at the time, just came to me and said, you know, can you come back next week? And I was like, yeah, of course I can. So I came back next week, and they like nodded us down to like 15 people.
Yeah, right.
And I got up first out of them 15. I sang, and then Nicky, who was also myself, he got up second.
Yeah.
And after the two of us had finished singing, they stopped the audition and said, we found our two guys.
No way.
So the other 13 comes in and go, bro.
Well,
that's good.
Well, Brian, it's been absolutely a pleasure, my friend.
Thank you
for dropping by.
Yeah.